our soul shall find rest beyond the grave. In this morning, Lord, we are going to express to say thanks to you for accepting to come and die on Calvary for us, so that today we can have abundant life. What a mighty God you are. And this morning we acknowledge that you are God. And we acknowledge that there is none like you. All other gods, they are the works of men. But you are the Most High God, and there is none like you. And this morning, oh God, we acknowledge that you are above all. You are the creator, governor of all things. And this morning, oh God, we lift up our hearts in worship just to express, oh God, of which you are in our lives. As we come this morning, each of us, oh God, we want a touch from you this morning. We want to hear from you this morning. And oh God, we ask you to give us an open mind so that we can hear clearly from you this morning. Lord, make our very will to us this morning. Make our very will to us this morning. This is our prayer, oh God, that Calvary will be will to us and others will come to you. Lord, bless us this morning as we open to listen to you, as we surrender everything to you over this morning. We see our praise. We see our worship of God this morning, and so that your blessing will come upon us this morning. Here we are over this morning. Touch us, O God, and transform us, and we know there is power in your blood to transform. There is power in your blood, O God, to make us new. And this morning, O God, we ask for grace, we ask for compassion, and we ask for blessing. Lord, bless us as we continue to worship you in your Son's divine name.
Because God, I know the blood we face, the blood of the risen man, power to save. Just as in olden days, the blood we face, no matter what others say, same call the blood we face. I know the blood.
Thank you. portion of this part of the of our service today can be found in Matthew chapter 27, verse 33 to 57. But I'm not going to read it this morning. I'm going to tell you the story. And hopefully, it's the story. It is not authentic, meaning that that is not how it is written in the scripture. I have taken some liberties with it, but as the Lord gave me the words, I pray that they will speak to you this morning. Just imagine you are hearing from the centurion at the cross. It did not seem any different at first. It was an ordinary day. Yes, as I look back now, there was nothing to suggest that it would turn out to be such an unforgettable day. There was going to be a crucifixion today. As soldiers, we had to be there to ensure that the peace was kept, that no one tried to free the prisoner, that there was no uprising, and that everything went smoothly. Crucifixion was the means that the Roman government used to keep the people in line, to deter them from any form of uprising, any act or even threat of treason or terrorism. The historians tell us that because Israel hated the occupying Roman troops, insurgents frequently arose among the populace. As a deterrent to stop people from participating in revolts, crucifixion was regularly practiced in Jerusalem. By publicly crucifying those who attempted to overthrow the government, the Romans sent a strong signal of fear to those who might try, or even to those who were tempted to follow in their footsteps or indulge in other criminal activities. The act itself was gruesome. It was torturous. It was excruciatingly painful, among other things. Only the worst criminals received that sentence. This one in particular was different. This man they had arrested, he did not seem like a criminal. As a matter of fact, they had no case on him at all. It was his own disciple who sold him for the price of a slave. When we got there to arrest him in the Garden of Gethsemane, we did not have to use force. We did not have to use any tactics. He just came forward and surrendered. And we even witnessed him healing the high priest's servant's ear.
Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and smote the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus.
But the one called Jesus, who would be crucified, he just took the man's ear and he made it whole again. This had me wondering, how could such a calm, good man be a criminal? And if he really was a criminal, then he was an unusual one. In his hour of arrest, instead of running, he willingly gave up himself. And when someone was in distress, he came and he met their need.
Jesus, knowing all that was going to happen to him, went out and asked them, "Who is it you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "I am he," Jesus said. And Judas the traitor was standing there with them. And when Jesus said, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, Who is it you want? Jesus of Nazareth, they said. Jesus answered, I told you that I am he. If you are looking for me, then let these men go. This happened so that the words he has spoken would be fulfilled. I have not lost one of those you gave me. Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. Jesus commanded Peter, put your sword away. Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me? Then the detachment of soldiers with its commander and the Jewish officials arrested Jesus. They bound him and brought him first to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jewish leaders that it would be good if one man died for the people.
From that moment onwards, I paid attention. Since I was the one in charge of all those soldiers, I had worked hard for this position, and I would not allow anything to happen under my watch. My soldiers mocked and they jeered throughout the trial. I suppose they had to entertain the crowd that had gathered there. As I said before, this kind of death was used to set an example to those who dared to rebel against the Roman government. And we, the soldiers, would do our best to ensure that they were crucified. We followed him everywhere. My soldiers were so intrigued with the reaction of the crowd that they went overboard. They put a robe on him, a crown of thorns. Some spat on him in disgust. But not a word of defense came out of this man. He was the best behaved criminal. He was the best behaved criminal I had ever come across. That was strange. And I wondered why he had been so quiet. Why didn't he defend himself? He refused to open his mouth.
All of us, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way. But the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he didn't open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to slaughter, and like a sheep that is silent before his shearers, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living for the transgression of my people, to whom the stroke was true.
Could he be innocent? I wonder. We went through Annas, then Pilate, then Felix, and back to Pilate. No one saw a troublemaker in him, but the people would not let him go free. By now, they were so worked up that all they wanted was blood. So Pilate washed his hands clean. He wanted no part of it, and he allowed the people to choose Jesus, to choose between Jesus and Barabbas. They chose to have Jesus crucified. So up to Golgotha I led the procession, while the others followed him carrying that heavy log. As we moved forward, stumbling and weary, they lashed him with their whips so he could not stop. They hurled insults at him all the way up to the little hill they referred to as the skull. There the soldiers positioned him on the beams before they put the nails in his hand and feet. He agonized.
But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Something indescribable happened. He kept praying for his accusers. He asked God to forgive them. As if that was not enough, then there was a great earthquake, and darkness covered the earth for 3 hours. As if nature itself mourned the death. The quake was a big one. The people who had been dead came to life again. Those standing around could not help. We were all afraid that something supernatural was happening. Then I knew it. My soldiers could sense that this Jesus was no mere mortal. A holy fear gripped us, and the cross, which that day was supposed to be a simple crucifixion, became a place of reverence, a place of salvation. I could not help but declare.
Then, behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth quaked, and the rocks were split, and the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the graves after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. So when the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and the things that happened, they feared greatly, saying, "Truly, this was the Son of God."
Just as in his baptism, God testified, yes, he testified that he was the Son. He was his Son. When he opened the heaven, he sent a sign in the form of a dove.
As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. Suddenly, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and resting on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Today, heaven opened once more, and God testified, "This is my Son. I gave him as a ransom for many." For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many.
I wonder, what would you think if you had been there, if you had heard him pray and ask God to forgive those who had done wrong? I wonder if you would have recognized that supernatural declaration. I wonder.
Oh, God.
God bless you.
Amen.